1 Samuel chapter 16. It's been wonderful to be in God's house. I've enjoyed all the good singing. Well, the choir singing this morning just was outstanding to me. I thought all the songs were just very fitting. I really feel the Lord stirring in my heart through those good words and those hymns. And I appreciate that this morning. Well, we're not going to read right off this morning. I want to kind of set us up to where we're at. And we are still talking about heroes of the Bible. And we're in this will be our sixth message that we brought in this series. And this morning we're going to look at the life of King David. We're going to look at him before he actually become king. And then tonight, Lord willing, we'll be continuing on with David, a different portion of his life. But this morning I want to look at what brought him up to the place that he became king and how he got there. Now, if you're much of a Bible scholar, you've been in church very long, you're probably familiar with how Israel came up with a king. They, for a long time, didn't have a king. And we know that they rejected God because God said to Samuel, he said, the people have not rejected you, but they've rejected me because they've asked for a king. You see, they wanted a king to go out and fight their battles. All these places they had went and had war against and had fought against, to get to the promised land that God gave them. By the way, that's the key there. God gave them. God fought their battles. God made them victorious. God led them where they were at. And yet they rejected God. They did not want to follow God. And they started following false idols. And they wanted to be like those nations that they had saw and they had lived around and conquered and still were living amongst them. They were led by kings. And so they look out and they said, we want a king. They demanded a king. Well, at that time, they'd been led by judges for the last 450 years. For 450 years, three centuries long, the children of Israel have been led by judges that God had appointed to rule over them and watch over them and to make sure they're being guided. And they had prophets among them. Well, the last real judge that they had was Samuel. And Samuel, he had some sons that didn't follow in his way. They were sons of Belial, the Bible says. And the people started murmuring and going on there. And they said, we want a king. And they demanded that they be appointed a king. Well, as Samuel brought this before God, he said, God, I don't understand why the people are doing this. They're not listening to me. They're rejecting me. And God said, they're not rejecting you. They're rejecting me. And he says, go ahead and let them have this thing that they're wanting. And so God allowed them to have what they thought that they wanted. And he told Samuel, he said, but you tell them this. You tell them they'll regret the day they ever asked for a king. And that's exactly what Samuel did. And he told the people, he said, God says he'll let you have a king, but friends, you're going to regret it from the day that you asked for it. Because they're going to take your sons. He's going to take your daughters. He's going to change things. He's going to take your lands, your properties. And you're going to regret the day that you ever asked for a king instead of God ruling over you. You see, they thought they needed someone tall, dark, and handsome to stand before them in a battlefield and lead them into battle. Friends, that's a good thing right there to remember. Be careful what you ask for because God may give it to you. And that's exactly what happened. He allowed them to have a king, and the Bible says that God anointed him as king, Saul. He anointed him as that. Had Samuel go and do it. And he gave him just the king that he wanted them to have because of their obedience. And for 40 years, they were under his rule. And by the time that was over, they were begging to be out from under his rule. And exactly like Samuel told them, they regretted it from the day it happened. Now, as we know, Saul did not get along with Samuel. Samuel had been the spiritual leader of Israel. And he didn't get along with Saul, or Saul didn't get along with him, I'm sorry. And Saul did not consult him like he should have. And he even went as far as to make a sacrifice because he was impatient waiting on Samuel to come back. Samuel was delayed and he didn't get back in the time that Saul thought he should. And so he took the sacrifice himself. And that was what marked him as rejected by God. That was the final straw. And God rejected Saul as king. And you can see that over in Acts 13 and 21. The Bible tells us exactly that God rejected him. So this, that brings us up to our opening text this morning, which is there in 1 Samuel 16 and 1. And the Bible says, "And the Lord said unto Samuel, How long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him for the reigning over Israel? Fill thine horn with oil, and go, and I will send thee to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided me a king among his sons." Let's pause right there for a second. If you notice, as we just mentioned, Saul did not really like Samuel. He didn't obey the things of God's man, what he said. And so there was tension there. But did you notice that even though that there was not a great relationship between Saul and Samuel, that Samuel was mourning the rejection of the king? He was mourning that. He wanted it all to work out. He wanted Saul to be successful, and he wanted God's people to be led and to have everything that they needed. And he was mourning over this. And God told him, he says, "You've got to quit mourning for Saul." He said, "Because I've got the real chosen king, the one, a man after my own heart, who's going to come in, and he's going to rule and reign." And he, oh, by the way, he just happens to be the son of a man named Jesse over in Bethlehem. Now, skip up to 1 Samuel 16 and 10. 1 Samuel 16 and 10. And here it says, "Again, Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said unto Jesse, The Lord has not chosen these." Samuel has went down to Jesse's place under the guise, well, it was actually the truth, of having a sacrifice. And he invites Jesse to bring all his sons to come with him. And the whole purpose here is so he can find the anointed one, the one that God chose as king. Well, Jesse had eight sons. But yet he decides he's going to only bring the seventh there and leave the young one out in the field tending the sheep. Well, after all, he's just a little scrawny guy. He's just a little, you know, a teenager. He's probably anywhere between 12 and 16 years old at this time. And he's like, well, there's no need for him to come here. He's probably like most teenagers, you know, he's probably going to come in here and start aggravating and things. And so they just left him out in the field while the real men came to the sacrifice there with the prophet. And so they're there, verse 11 says, "And Samuel said unto Jesse, Are here all thy children? He said, There remaineth yet the youngest, and behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, Send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he come hither." You see, Samuel has already seen that God has said no. He 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 said no. He, all these sons that Samuel thought, boy, this is it right here. Look at this guy. He's clearly the king. And God said, no, that's not him. There's another. And so he knows there's someone else there. God cannot be wrong. And he says, well, bring that young man out of the field. Bring him in here. He said, we're not going to sit down. We're not going to do anything until he's here. And so verse 12 says, and he sent and he brought him in. Now he was ruddy and withal of a beautiful countenance and goodly to look to. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Can you imagine just being a young teenager, walk in there and see he's ruddy? That means he's got reddish hair. He's probably fair complexion. He's a real good-looking boy. A nice-looking, and it's known here, the Bible mentions it. And he comes in here, and God says, right there it is. That's the one that I want to be anointed as king. Imagine the surprise on everybody's face when this happens. And Samuel, verse 13, took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. Make sure you pay close attention to that little phrase right there. If you underline things, underline that phrase. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. Friends, that is the key phrase in the life of David. From the time he was anointed king of Israel, it says the Spirit of the Lord, Jehovah, came upon him. This wasn't just some everyday... I'm sure David had natural abilities. He was a talented young man. But until he was anointed by God to be king, he didn't have this spiritual walk that he should have had. He didn't have this anointing that God had put upon him, this power, it's supernatural that he's gave David. And friends, it has set him apart. It's marked him as different than everybody else. And it came upon him, the Spirit. And then look, let's see what happened. Verse 14, but the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him. And Saul's servant said unto him, behold, now an evil spirit from God troubleth thee. Let our Lord now command thy servants which are before thee to seek out a man who is a cunning player on the harp. And shall come to pass when the evil spirit from God is upon thee, that he shall play with his hand, and thou shalt be well. And Saul said unto his servants, provide me now a man that can play well, and bring him to me. Then answered one of the servants, said, behold, I've seen a son of Jesse the Bethlehemite, that is cunning and playing, a mighty and valiant man, and a man of war, and prudent in matters, and a comely person, and the Lord is with him. Wherefore Saul sent messengers unto Jesse, and said, send me David thy son, which is with the sheep. And there in verse 18 is where we're going to get the thrust of our message from this morning. I've got four things in the life of David that we see as a young man, a very early age, makes him a true hero of God. It makes him different. He's a true hero of God. The first one being, true heroes are cunning. True heroes are cunning. Did you see that there where it said in verse 18 that is cunning and playing? Now, when we think of the word cunning, we think of being used by villains. You know, they're sneaky and they devise plans in their mind and they work them out. They're real cunning at it. They're deceptive. Well, David could do those things too, and he did at times. But that's not what this word is speaking of in this context right here. It's not being really a bad type of cunning. It's a good one. It means he's careful, he's skillful, and he's observant. A true hero is careful, skillful, and observant. They're very cunning. Not only is a true hero that way, but a Christian should be cunning in all matters. And often in our English language, we tend to think differently than what our context for our Bible says. But we see that even back in when Nebuchadnezzar was there in the book of Daniel, when he was seeking out those young men he was going to bring into captivity and to make good men of and servants of, he chose those, the Bible said, that were cunning. Cunning. That means they were skillful, observant. They were good students. That's what David was. He was a good student. And here the Bible says he's cunning at playing. That don't mean he really knows how to play red light, green light, or hopscotch, or something like that. That means playing on that beautiful harp that he played. And perhaps you were like me. In high school, I was in the band. I was in the marching band, the concert band, and I played trombone. And there was several trombone players there with us. I happened to be first chair. I was a first chair trombone player. But there's three types of trombone players. There's the type that's just, you know, mediocre. They learn the notes, they can play. You can put a piece of sheet music in front of them, they can play the music. And, you know, they do a fairly good job. They do fine. There's another kind that's there because their parents are forcing them to play an instrument. They hate it. They don't want anything to do with anybody in there. And they're awful at the instrument. And they sit there and they make a racket. And they're usually the ones the band instructor says, why don't you just sit out on this number right here? And then there's a third kind. There's a third kind who is very cunning. He's very skillful. He's very knowledgeable with the instrument. He's really been practicing and playing it. Well, I was probably that first one, that mediocre one. I could play good. I was first chair, you know, and I did fine. I could take it or leave it, really. But there was a guy there. His name was Ron Rogers. And some of y'all may know him. Ron Rogers was the most cunning trombone player in the entire school. He could sit down with a piece of music, and friends, you just want to sit there in awe and listen to him. He could take a trombone and make it sound like anything you want. I mean, he was good. He practiced. He studied. He was there before everybody else was there in class. He was waiting in line. And he was very good. He was the type of guy that you wanted to be like if you wanted to be a trombone player. Well, he was the type of guy that also went on to UT, played in the band, and then became a band teacher. Very cunning with an instrument. Well, obviously, David, even as a young boy, was very skillful. He was knowledgeable. He paid attention to detail. He must have been heard by other people playing his harp. Was he sitting out there on the grassy slopes on the hills outside of Bethlehem, watching over the sheep at night, maybe strumming a harp? Was he doing that? Did he take it with him? You know, some of those harps are huge. You ever been around a professional harp player? Those things are like 6 feet tall. Some of them are smaller. Was he out there with a harp playing in the fields? Did he take it with him to worship when they all came to worship? and David would start out the music playing the harp. How did they know about David being skillful on that? They heard him somewhere. How did they know? Friends, he used the talent that God gave him. He was very cunning at it. I imagine he sat down and he would strum his fingers over the strings. Probably closed his eyes and listened to them as they made the sounds. And he knew each one and how much pressure to put on it. He was very skillful, very knowledgeable. I remember back in July, we gave our daughter Elizabeth a guitar for her birthday. And she had never really played a guitar. And I give it to her, show her a few, chords to play. And she sits down and she starts playing the chords. And then like 2 or 3 days later, I'm walking by her room and she's in there playing a song. I can hear her playing. You can hear her every day and all night up to we forced her to go to bed. She'd be in her bedroom playing on the guitar. And within like a month, she's playing music and writing songs. She became very cunning in a very early age. She stood here and played and sang Amazing Grace on a guitar she had for 2 months. She was very skillful because she applied that knowledge that she had that God gave her to sit down and learn something. Friends, a true hero, a true Christian, will study the craft. You can't expect to get any further in your walk with God by just sitting around and waiting for it to happen. How many people do you know today that do this? They get saved and they say, I want to do something for the Lord. And what do? They come into church. They sit down on the pew like this right here. And they look around. And when we sing songs, they pick up a hymn book. They sing a song. We read out of the Bible. They pick it up. They read out of the Bible. And then when church is over, they get up and they walk out the door. And that's as far as their Christian walk goes. They come back the next church service and do it all over again. And then they come and they say, Brother Byron, I don't understand why I can't really understand what God wants for me. What is my skill? What is the thing that I need to be doing for God? Well, first of all, it requires actually getting up off the pew. There's much more than just holding this pew down to the floor. Those guys that changed out the pews, they put screws in all those. And friends, they're down to the floor good. They're not going anywhere. They don't need your help. It requires us getting up, and it requires us studying our Word. People tell me, I don't understand the Bible. I don't understand what God means by this and that. But they don't open it and read it. They don't understand it because they don't read it. Friends, it's not subliminal. You don't hold it like this to your head and it absorb into you. You actually have to read the words, and that's how a Christian becomes very cunning at the Word and at the Scriptures. David had that gift of being cunning. If we want to be more Christ-like, we need to be a cunning Christian. Jesus says in Matthew 10:6, Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Have you ever had a Jehovah's Witness come to your front door? I'd say almost everybody in here has had one of them come to your front door. They come to your door and they hold in their hand a Bible that looks identical to yours. And they will stand there and they will open it up and they will read a verse of Scripture. And they'll say, do you believe that? Well, sure I do. That's out of God's Word. I believe that. And then they'll say something that's just a little bit different. And you may question it, but then you'll say, well, it sounds reasonable. And that is how they go around from door to door, house to house, trying to increase the numbers in their cult by opening up and giving you a false word from God. They've got their own little society that they get their words from. And they present them differently than what the Bible teaches. And that's how Christians today will get fooled into these cults like this. Friends, we need to be cunning today. We need to be skillful. We need to read and understand and study our Word. Or yes, we will be fooled very easily. 2 Thessalonians 2:13 says, But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God has from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. If you want to become cunning as a Christian, it's that sanctification process that we all go through when you're saved. A true hero is cunning. Secondly, a true hero, if you see there in verse 18, it went on to say that David was a mighty, valiant man. True heroes are valiant. They're valiant. Not only was he cunning, but he was a mighty, valiant man. Not just valiant, but mighty valiant. This word valiant means strong, powerful, brave, bold, And most importantly, having virtue and valor. Virtue and valor. I'm reminded of John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress. If you ever read that, you may remember Mr. Valiant for proof. As Christian was headed to the celestial city, and they come up, and Mr. Valiant for truth is standing in the roadway holding a sword with a bloody face. And he's standing there, and they say, "Hey, what happened here?" And he said, "There was three men that came and tried to kill me, and I fended them all off with my sword." And they said, "Well, I'm surprised you're not worn out." And he said this, and I wrote his quote down. He said, "I fought till my sword did cleave to my hand. And when they were joined together, as if a sword grew out of my arm. And when the blood ran through my fingers, then I fought with most courage." And by the way, Mr. Valiant for truth played the harp. I thought that was interesting. David's reputation for courage, his skill, his determination, his discretion, and even his good looks were already great, were already known, even as a young man. And that's pretty miraculous. Since the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, this all happened. Now, his feat for killing the lion and the bear with his hands is already known. He's become a hero even before he's become a man. A true hero, like David, is a valiant man. As a Christian, we may not physically wield a sword. We may not stand out. Now, you may come a day when we will have to stand out there and defend ourselves physically. But right now, just like Sister June said at the beginning of the service, we come into church today with nobody trying to stop us. Nobody at all. Maybe the ACLU or something's trying to write a law to stop us, but there's nobody that came out physically trying to bar you from coming to church. There's places today that they're doing that. There's places I read today that there's a place where there's 100,000 Christians in concentration camps being tortured because they believe in Christ. I want you to know that's going on all over the world today, but we did not have to worry about that today. And we must do what the Bible tells us to do if we want to be valiant. And what does the Bible tell us? Ephesians 6:10. Ephesians 6:10, if you want to turn there, up in the New Testament, Apostle Paul wrote this. Ephesians 6:10, and you may remember this from our Bible school. This was our theme. It says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints." I hear people tell me, they said, "Brother Byron, I'm trying my best. I'm trying to live for the Lord. I'm trying to be the best Christian that I can be, but my life just seems to fall apart. It seems like every time I turn around, something bad's happened to me. It seems like I get in the wrong relationships. It seems like I say the wrong things and do the wrong things. What am I doing wrong? I'm trying." You've got one question. Are you putting on the armor of God? Are you doing what the Bible says to do as a Christian? Are you putting on that armor? And you know what, sadly, the answer is, "Well, no, I'm not doing that." Well, what are you doing? Are you expecting to get up and do the same thing every day and there be a different outcome? If you do the same thing over and over, the same outcome is going to happen. You've got to make a change somewhere. Where's that change at? It's in your relationship with Christ. And what does He say that we have to do? He says that we're not only fighting against flesh and blood, but we're fighting a battle here. And it's against spiritual darkness and wickedness. Friends, the devil, Satan, don't you mark him out as somebody that's a little guy with a red tail and a fork and things like that. Don't you believe that lie today. Friends, that's not the devil. The devil comes to you. He wants to deceive you. He wants to bring you down. If you're saved, he can't touch your salvation, but he can touch your life. He can make your life miserable. He will lead you into temptations. And you know what you have to do? You have to do what the Bible says. He says to shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel. He says to take on that shield of faith. And he says to put on that helmet of salvation, that sword of the Spirit. And by the way, it says, which is the Word of God. How many people go out day by day wondering what's wrong in their life, and they've not even cracked open the Word of God? How in the world do you think you're ever going to understand God's will for your life? How do you think you'll ever walk the Christian life that you want to live? He didn't put this in here to be used only as a vacation Bible school thing. He didn't put it in there as just something really fancy words to say or for kids to dress up in Sunday school about. He put that in there because He wants us to live a victorious Christian life. He wants your walk with Him to be victorious. And that's why He put these words in here. That's why we need to do the things the Bible tells us to. Don't tell me you're doing everything when you're not. Don't tell me that you don't know where to turn when it's here and you're not turning there. True Christians, true heroes, live a life of valor. The valor. Thirdly, true heroes are prudent in matters. Verse 18, they kept on going, said about David, and prudent in matters. Can you imagine that being known of him as just a young man? Prudent in matters. This word prudent means acting with or showing care and thought about matters. I mean, he was very thoughtful. He wasn't one of those that just on any little whim, something happens and he makes a knee-jerk decision. We got too many knee-jerkers today. Something comes up and they say, ooh, do this. Well, wait a minute, did you consult God about that? Or were you prudent in that matter? Did you really consider really the outcome of what you're suggesting? And most of the time, listen, well, no, I didn't have time to think about it. I just made a decision. Well, that's the wrong way to address it. Friends, David took great care in his talk, in his conversations, in his conduct, in his behavior. Everything about David's life was trained with prudence. I mean, even as a young man, would to God today that Christians would live a more prudent life. I hear that phrase being used about people. People say, oh, they're a prudent. They'll look at a woman wearing a dress or a skirt out in public and say, she's a prudent. And what they really mean is she's much older than I am. That's what they mean. But yet they'll look at somebody like that and say, they're just prudes. You know? In most churches today, you can't tell the church from the world. And it ought not to be that way. It ought not to be that way. Now before you go and say, oh boy, here he goes. I want you to know, if you've known me for any time, I have never checked him lines at the door. I've never told anybody what they can or cannot wear. I've never been one to say, wait a minute now, friends, we don't allow that in here. But you can't come in here all tattooed and earringed up. There's churches that do that. Friends, I've never done that. I believe if a person is being drawn by the Spirit to come in the house of God, they want to hear the gospel preached. I don't care if they got pink hair. I don't care if they got nose rings. I don't care if they got tattoos. I don't care if they're wearing blue jeans. I don't care what they're dressed like. If they want to come in and listen to the gospel preached, they need to come in and listen to the gospel preached. Nobody needs to be excluded from hearing the gospel preached. But I want you to know today, if you're a Christian and you're in your sanctification, you're walking daily as a Christian, you're studying the Word of God, and you're being in tune with the Holy Spirit, He is telling you how to live your life. He tells you in His Word how He wants you to dress. He tells you how He wants you to behave, how He wants you to act. He instructs us in His Word what He wants from us. So if you're doing the things you need to do according to the Word, you will walk in a prudent matters. You will be a prudent Christian. You won't be identified as just the world. If they put you in a lineup with the rest of the world, with a lost sinner, they put you in a lineup, would they convict you as a Christian? Or would they say, well, I can't tell any difference here? They should be able to tell difference. That includes the way we dress, the way we talk, the way we conduct our business, the way we act in public and private. There's a separation between a Christian and a lost. You probably heard that phrase about someone being approved, like I mentioned. Friends, I want you to know we need more proofs today. We need more people. We're just like they were back in the days of the judges when the Bible says that every man was doing what he thought was right in his own eyes. Friends, that's what the world is doing today. Whatever they think is right in their own eyes. And we know what that leads to. Anarchy. That's what it leads to. We need more people saying, what is it God wants in my life? What is it that God thinks is right? And He tells us in His Word what is right. Friends, we need more of that today. We need more heroes to stand up and be proven. We need more Christians to be proven in all matters. Fourth and final thing, true heroes walk with God. Verse 18 went on to say that David, it said, and the Lord is with him. Now, we already read how the Lord was with him when Samuel anointed him. It said that the Lord came upon him and that he was filled with the Holy Spirit there. It didn't say that, the Holy Spirit, but he was filled with the Lord's Spirit. Would to God today that somebody would say that about you? Wouldn't you love that? If somebody come up and said, you know so-and-so, yeah, the Lord walks with him. He walks with the Lord. Yeah, I know him. Oh, wouldn't you love that if people said that about you? What are they saying in his place? Do you know Brother Byron? Oh, yeah, he's that guy. You don't want nothing to do with him. Is that the first thing to think of? Or do they think he walks with God? He walks with the Lord. The Lord walks with him. I wish that people would say that. How do we know that David walked with God? Have you ever read the Psalms? Look at the first Psalm. Look at the first one. It says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. In his law doth he meditate day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. If every Christian today would live the life David talks about right here, of being with the Lord. True heroes walk with God. True heroes walk with God. True Christians walk with God. How many people today that profess to be Christians, and yet their walk is definitely not a Christian walk? They go about doing things that are evil and awful, participating in the same things that the sin and sinful world would participate in. Friends, what do you think God thinks about that? Now, I know all about grace. I preach grace. Grace is the most wonderful thing God's ever gave us. And liberty, we have liberty in Christ. But that liberty is not to be used as a vice. It's not to be used as an excuse for sin. Should we sin just so grace would abound? Lord, no, we should not. Heaven, no, we should not. We should live a life with God. We should walk with Him daily. It should be known about you if you walk with God. That's that person. That's that person that walks with God. I see him go to church on Sunday. I watch them as they pull out the driveway on Sunday mornings. They even go on Sunday nights. And you know what? On Wednesday nights, after they've worked all day, they go to church. They walk with God. When I come and talk to them, when I can just tell them, they start mentioning stuff about church. They start talking about what the Lord did for them. When I see them out somewhere, they're talking to other people. They're talking about the Lord. They're talking about a church. They walk with God. Don't you wish that people would say that about you? Or do they say, man, they say they're Christian, but I can't tell. Friends, we need to walk with God. True heroes are coming. True heroes are valiant. True heroes are prudent in all matters. True heroes walk with God. Let's do an examination this morning as they come and give the invitation song. Let's look inside our hearts this morning and see, do we contain all these attributes of a true hero? By the way, as I've mentioned in all these messages, these attributes apply not only to heroes, but to Christians. Are we walking this way? Are we knowing this? Does the Lord know you that way? As we sing this invitation number, I want you to stand.